Good morning. I am G. Mohan Babu, working as an assistant professor in the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering in PSNA College of Engineering and Technology, Dindigul. Today, in this session, we are going to see about the digital communication system. Before entering into the topic, first of all, what do you mean by communication? Communication is the process of establishing a connection or link between many points. Then what is digital communication? Digital communication involves digital information that is being transmitted and received via some transmission medium. Then what is digital communication system? Digital communication system, it has a transmitter, a receiver, and in between transmitter and receiver we have a transmission medium and associated electronic circuits to process the information that is being transmitted. Like for example, we have seen the picture which consists of a sender and receiver. In between, communication link through some analog signal is carried out. Consider an example. I am staying in Dindigul and my friend is staying in Chennai. I want to send some parcel to my friend who is in Chennai, so that I will need the help of some courier service. So I approach courier service. I will put the parcel in some courier office. In the courier office, they need the two address, so that I have to write the two address. Then that will be kept in the van or bus to carry over the Chennai. Then it will reach the Chennai courier office, where it is being dispatched to the person who is the receiver. Here the sender, that is me, is the transmitter, and receiver, my friend, is the receiver. In the transmission medium is the bus or van, which carries the actual information. This is what the block diagram of digital radio system. What is digital radio system? Whenever being used to send digital information, that is which changes only between a logic 1 and a logic 0, that is discrete levels, then if we use the communication medium as the Earth's atmosphere, then it is called as digital radio system. In this block diagram, we have three different parts. The first one is transmitter. The second part is transmission media. The third part is receiver. In the transmitter section, first we have the precoder. The precoder block is used to make the level of the input data to be suitable in the form of transmitter, along with the clock pulses that are generated by the clocking oscillator. That suitably encoded data will be sent to the modulator. Modulation is the process of placing the low frequency information signal over a high frequency carrier signal. That analog carrier signal is generated with the help of some oscillator, and it will be coming to the modulator, so that we can place the low frequency information signal to the high frequency carrier. That will be sent to the band pass filter, BPF. Band pass filter is nothing but it allows only a particular frequency band signals, and it won't allow the frequency signals that are apart from that particular frequency band. Say for example, if we consider voice frequency band signal, which lies between 300 Hz to 3000 Hz, that type of bandpass filter will be designed for only particular that 300 Hz to 3000 Hz frequency band. It won't allow either below 300 Hz or above 3000 Hz. And then we have an amplifier. Amplifier is an electronic circuit that is used to increase the amplitude level of the low frequency information signal. Then it will be sent to the transmission medium. Transmission medium may be either wired channel or wireless channel. In case of wired channel, we use metallic wire, coaxial cable, fiber optical cable called OFC. In case of wireless channel, we use Earth's atmosphere as the medium. Then the modulated signal now reaches the third section, receiver. In receiver, again we have band pass filter, which allows only a particular frequency band. Because while propagating via transmission medium, the modulated signals may get distorted because of the noise presence in the Earth's atmosphere. So we need to first filter the modulated signal, and then we have to amplify to make the strongest signal. Then it will be given to the demodulated section. Demodulation is the process of extracting the original information that is contained in the modulated signal. That is, we need only information signal, low frequency information signal that is present in the modulated signal. We don't need anyway the high frequency carrier signal once we receive the information. So we need to demodulate in the receiver section. And the decoder is used to get the original form of information signal because in the precoder it is already encoded. So we have to do decoding in the receiver side. Along with the demodulator and decoder, we have to use carrier and clock recovery. To get the actual information signal, the carrier recovery circuit helps to achieve such that we use the same frequency and phase angle of the reference carrier used in the transmitter section. Then only we can retrieve the actual information. And the clock pulses that are used in the transmitter side will be again retrieved by the clock recovery circuit. The low pass filter called as LPF is used in the receiver side because mostly information signal will be contained in the low frequency signals only. In the high frequency, carrier signals are removed with the help of low pass filter. In the modulation and demodulation topic, we are going to discuss about the definition of modulation and demodulation, need for modulation, types of modulation, advantages and applications of modulation. Definition of modulation. Modulation is the process of converting the parameter of high frequency carrier signal, either it may be amplitude, frequency or phase angle, in accordance with the low frequency information signal. This is what our low frequency information signal, this is what our carrier signal. Usually carrier signal will be an analog high frequency signal. Then types of modulation. Modulation may be broadly classified into three categories. First one is analog modulation. Second one is digital modulation. And the third one is pulse modulation. In analog modulation, we have amplitude modulation, shortly termed as AM. Second one is frequency modulation, shortly termed as FM. And third one is phase modulation, shortly termed as PM. In amplitude modulation, the amplitude of high frequency carrier is varied in accordance with the low frequency information signal. In frequency modulation, the frequency of the carrier, analog carrier signal is varied in accordance with the low frequency information signal. In phase modulation, the phase angle of the carrier is varied in accordance with the low frequency information signal. In digital modulation, we have first one, amplitude shift keying, shortly termed as ASK. Second one, frequency shift keying, shortly termed as FSK. Third one, phase shift keying, shortly termed as PSK. Fourth one, quadrature amplitude modulation, shortly termed as QAM. In amplitude shift keying, we are going to vary the amplitude of high frequency carrier analog signal with respect to the low frequency digital information signal. In frequency shift keying, we are going to vary the frequency of high frequency analog carrier signal in accordance with the digital information signal. In phase shift keying, we are going to vary the phase angle of the high frequency carrier signal with respect to the digital information signal. Quadrature amplitude modulation combines both ASK and PSK. In pulse modulation, we have pulse width modulation, shortly termed as PWM. Pulse position modulation, shortly termed as PPM. Pulse amplitude modulation, shortly termed as PAM. Pulse code modulation, shortly termed as PCM. In pulse width modulation, the width of the pulse is going to be varied in accordance with the information signal. In pulse position modulation, the position of the pulse is going to be varied in accordance with the information signal. In pulse amplitude modulation, the amplitude level is varied in accordance with the information signal. The pulse code modulation is actually a coding technique in which the above three technique will be coded with the help of binary information like zeros and ones. This is what pulse code modulation. The general expression for a time varying sine wave of voltage such as high frequency carrier signal is given by V of t is equal to V sine 2 pi ft plus theta. Here V represents amplitude of high frequency analog carrier signal. F represents frequency of analog carrier signal. Theta represents phase angle of analog carrier signal. If we change the amplitude, then we will be getting amplitude shift keying. If we change the frequency of carrier signal in accordance with the digital information signal, then we get the frequency shift keying. If we change the phase angle of the analog carrier signal, then we get the phase shift keying. Both ASK and PSK can be combined to get quarter-inch amplitude modulation. Then, advantages of digital modulation. The first advantage is the processing becomes much easier when compared with analog modulation, because we deal with only with digital information signal which has only two discrete levels, either logic 1 or logic 0. So it's become easier to operate with the digital modulation techniques. Second one is multiplexing becomes easier. Multiplexing is the process of transmitting information from many sources to many destinations via single channel. Multiplexing may be broadly classified into time division multiplexing and frequency division multiplexing. In time division multiplexing, different time slots are allocated for different signals, whereas in frequency division multiplexing, different frequency bands are allocated, but at the same time all the signals will be transported via transmission medium. Noise immunity is very less. Then applications of digital modulation. It is widely used in many areas. Low speed voice band data communication modems such as in personal computer, high speed data transmission systems such as broadband digital subscriber line, shortly termed as DSL, digital microwave and satellite communication systems, cellular telephone personal communication system. These are the few applications of digital modulation system. The first method in digital modulation is the amplitude shift keying, which we are going to discuss now. In amplitude shift keying, the binary information signal directly modulates the amplitude of analog high frequency carrier signal. Mathematically, amplitude shift keying ASK is represented by V ASK of t is equal to 1 plus Vm of t multiplied by A by 2 cos omega ct. Say this is equation 1. In this equation, Vm of t represents the amplitude of digital information signal in volts. A represents the amplitude of high frequency analog carrier signal in volts. Omega c represents angular frequency of carrier signal, that is equal to omega c is equal to 2 pi fc, where fc is the carrier central frequency in hertz. There are two cases in the operation of amplitude shift keying. The first case is whenever we give the logic 1 input to the system, that is Vm of t, that is voltage of modulating signal, is equal to plus 1 volt in this case, then equation 1 becomes Vas of t is equal to 1 plus 1 multiplied by A by 2 cos omega ct. It can be simplified and we get the answer Vask of t is equal to A cos omega ct. If we go for the next case, that is whenever we are applying logic 0 input to the system, then Vm of t0, that is amplitude of modulating signal, is represented by minus 1 volt, which we are going to substitute in the equation 1. Then 1 becomes Va square of t is equal to 1 minus 1 multiplied by a by 2 cos omega ct. Definitely it will become 0. Hence, the modulated by Va square of t is either cos omega, a cos omega ct or 0. That is, whenever the positive stream enters into the system, the carrier appears at the output. And on the other hand, whenever the negative digital stream enters into the system, that is logic 0 enters into the system, we don't get any carrier output. That is, for every change in the input binary stream, there is a change in the amplitude shift keying waveform. Hence, the carrier is either on or off, depends upon the application of digital information signal. And hence, the system is called as, ISK is also called as on off keying. That is, it alternately on and off, simply called as OOK. The rate of change of amplitude shift keying waveform, that is called as baud rate, is the same as the rate of binary input that we have applied. That we have applied the binary input as FB, so that is the baud rate. Baud rate is equal to FB. This is for the input and output waveform of amplitude shift keying digital modulation. The first wave represents digital information, which alternately ones and zeros. That is, this is logic 1 and this is logic 0. Logic 1, logic 0. And the second wave represents high frequency analog carrier signal. Then the third wave represents the output. That is, from the waveform it is clear that whenever there is a logic 1 input, the carrier that corresponds to that logic appears at the output. Whenever there is a logic 0 input modulating signal, we don't get any carrier signal at the output. Whenever there is a logic 1 input at the modulating signal, we get the corresponding carrier signal at the output. And whenever there is 0 logic, then carrier is absent. The next method is frequency shift keying digital modulation technique. In frequency shift keying, the modulating signal is a binary signal that varies between two discrete voltage levels, logic 1 and logic 0. The general expression for frequency shift keying is VFSK, frequency shift keying of with respect to time is equal to VC cos 2 pi multiplied by FC plus VM of t del of t. Say this is equation 2. Here, VC represents the amplitude of analog carrier signal. FC represents the central carrier frequency in hertz. Vm of t represents the amplitude of digital information signal in volts. Del f is the frequency deviation. That is, frequency is going to be shifted. That deviation is denoted by del f here. In the operation, we have again two cases. In the first case, whenever there is a logic 1 input appears at the system, Vm of t is equal to plus 1 volt. Then, if we substitute this value in the equation 2, we get Vfsk of t is equal to Vc cos 2 pi Fc plus, since it is 1, del f of t. In the second case, whenever we apply logic 0 input, then Vm of t is equal to minus 1 volt. If we substitute this value into the equation 2, we get Vfsk of t is equal to Vc cos 2 pi Fc minus del f t. From this equation, it is clear that the carrier center frequency del f is shift del f is proportional to the amplitude of binary input signal Vm of t. The direction of shift is determined by the polarity. That is, either logic 1 means positive, logic 0 means negative. When the binary input FB changes from logic 1 to 0, the frequency shift keying output frequency shift from mark frequency FM to space frequency FS. Mark frequency is nothing but whenever we are applying logic 1 input, if the frequency is shifted upwards, that frequency is termed as mark frequency. Whenever we apply logic zero input, then the frequency of the carrier signal will be shifted downwards, deviated downwards, and the corresponding frequency is called a space frequency, FS. The central frequency FC is selected such that it falls exactly halfway between mark and space frequencies. This is what the FSK transmitter diagram. We use the voltage controlled oscillator in the FSK modulator. We apply binary input signal and we get the output as either FM or FS, correspondingly digital information that is applied. Yeah. A logic 1 input shift the VCO output to the mark frequency FM. A logic 0 input shift the VCO output to the space frequency. Frequency deviation or shift is defined as the half difference between mark and space frequency. That is, delta F is equal to modulus of FM minus FS over 2. In the frequency domain, the same process is represented. That is, FC represents the carrier center frequency. This is what mark frequency that corresponds to frequency deviation to the upwards. FS represents space frequency, that frequency deviation corresponds to lower shift. So the carrier frequency is shifted up and down in the frequency domain by the application of binary input signal. So this is what the FSK input and output waveforms. The first waveform is the digital information signal that has only two discrete levels, binary levels, either 1 or 0. 1, 0. The carrier frequency will be a high frequency analog signal. Whenever there is a logic 1 input, then as we have already seen, FM will be applied. That is here, this one. Whenever logic 0 input is applied, we get the FSK modulator signal as space frequency, that is shown in the figure. That is here, frequency is varying, but amplitude is kept constant. Next, we have to see frequency shift in receiver power. Receiver power, we have demodulation. Demodulation process is nothing but a retrieval of original digital information from the modulated wave. There are three methods in the FSK receiver. First one is non-coherent FSK demodulator. Second one is coherent FSK demodulator. Third one is phase locked loop frequency shift keying receiver. So the first one is non-coherent FSK demodulator. Here, the frequency shift keying is waveform is applied as the input to the power splitter. This power splitter splits the two frequencies that are present in the FSK input. That is FM and FS. It splits FM and FS to two different filters. The bandpass filter in the lower section allows only the signals that corresponds to mark frequencies. It won't allow space frequency. That likewise the bandpass filter is designed. The bandpass filter present in the top is designed in such a way that it allows only the signals that corresponds to space frequency. It won't allow the signals that corresponds to mark frequency. That FS and FM will be separately applied to two identical envelope detector. Envelope detector is nothing but we have an active device called diode. Because the input analog signal will be rectified with the help of diode which is present in the envelope detector. So at the output of envelope detector we get the DC rectified signal. That rectified signals will be applied to the comparator. An operational amplifier op amp acts as a comparator. It separates both the signals corresponds to mark and space frequencies. Thus, we get the data output. But this is a very simple method. The problem is this accuracy because there is no frequency involved, only amplitude is involved in this operation. So, we go for the next method, which is the coherent FSK demodulator. In coherent FSK demodulator, same process, the frequency shift keying input is applied to the power splitter, which splits into two different frequencies, mark and space frequencies. Before applying to the filter, this splitted frequency will be multiplied with the coherent carrier waveform. That is, the carrier, recovered carrier used in this process will be having same frequency and phase angle that we have used in the transmitter side, that is modulation side. So that coherent pairing is going to be multiplied with both FM and FS separately. We get the multiplied output to the input of low pass filter, because I have already told the low frequency information signal has to be separated in the receiver. So separately we are applying. At the output we get the DC signals because of the help of envelope detector. And finally these two DC signals will be separately applied to the comparator, and based on the comparator output we get the data output. But the problem in coherent FSK demodulator is it is not practical to reproduce a local reference that is coherent with both FM and FS. Sometimes it may get for FM and it won't match for FS. Sometimes it may get for FS and it won't match for FM. That is the problem associated with coherent FSK model. To overcome these drawbacks, we go for the next demodulator method called as phase lock loop, shortly termed as PLL, frequency shifting demodulator. In PLL, FSK demodulator, we have a phase comparator, an amplifier, that is operational amplifier, and voltage controlled oscillator. First, the frequency shifting waveform is applied as the input to the phase comparator. Since there are only two frequencies, that is Mach and space frequencies, the DC analog voltage obtained at the output of op-amp will be having two different error values, DC error values. So that will be sent to the voltage controlled oscillator, which is designed for central carrier frequency, and that will be again applied to the phase comparator. And finally, we will be getting the binary input information signal that is applied in the transmitter side. So this is what the suitable method, because it has more accuracy. But in general, when compared with phase shift keying or QAM method, frequency shift keying is only suitable for low performance, low cost, asynchronous data models. Then we have to see the binary phase shift keying. Here it follows number of possible outputs m is equal to 2 power n. N is number of inputs applied. In this system, we use only one input, so m will become 2 power 1, that is equal to 2. Two phases are possible for carry. One phase represents a logic 0 and the other phase represents logic 1. As the input digital signal changes from 1 to 0 or from 0 to 1, the phase of output carrier shifts between two angles that are separated by 180 degrees. This is what the block diagram that depicts binary phase shift keying transmitter. Here, the binary input signal will be applied as the input of the level converter. The level converter is used to convert the level to the suitable form of modulation. That is, when we apply, we get only 0, lower level is 0 and the upper level is plus 12. The level converter converts it to the suitable level, plus V, the higher level is plus voltage and the lower level is minus voltage, usually plus 1 and minus 1 volts. Then it will be applied to the balanced modulator along with the reference carrier signal that is obtained from the carrier oscillator, usually analog signal, sine omega, sine waveform, sine omega ct. That will be sent to the modulator, which carries the actual information signal via some buffer. Then the output of the modulator signal will be given to the bandpass filter that is designed to a particular frequency band signal. Here, the balanced modulator is a ring modulator that we are going to discuss. Balanced ring modulator will be having two transformers, T1 and T2. In between T1 and T2 transformers, it will be having four diodes, D1, D2, D3 and D4. Four identical diodes are used here. The binary data is given as the input to the secondary of transformer T1, and the carrier signal, reference carrier input, is supplied to the primary of transformer T1, and accordingly we get the modulator output. The first case, whenever we apply plus volt, that is binary logic 1, which represents plus 1 volt, to the secondary of transformer, and whenever we apply sin omega CT, 700 degree, to the primary of the transformer, because of this positive signal, the sin omega CT appears exactly at the output. That is, there is no phase shift at all. The same phase that we applied will be applied at the output of the system. Here we can see, here we apply sin omega CT, and it represents here the same without any phase reversal, it is applied here. Because whenever a positive voltage appears here, diodes D1 and D2 becomes forward biased, and hence becomes both D1 and D2s are on. That is short circuited here. And because of this positive voltage, D3 and D4 diodes will become reverse biased. That is, it becomes off, and hence open circuit. That is what shown in the figure. D1, D2 diodes are on condition. D3 and D4 diodes are in off condition. So that only we get the same phase angle of the carrier that we have applied in the input to the output. If we go to the next case, that is, whenever we apply a logic 0, that is minus 1 volt, simultaneously with the carrier input signal, that is sin omega CT, we will be getting the phase reversal, that is 180 degree out of phase at the output. We can see here we are applying sin omega CT, that is represented with the waveform. In the output, it is 180 degree shifted, and we get the output like that. That is 180 degree shifted because of the plus 1 volt, that is logic 0 input. What happens is, whenever we are applying logic 0, these two diodes, diode D1 and D2, becomes reverse bias, and hence becomes off. And diode D3 and D4 becomes forward bias and becomes on. So that only we get a phase reversal at the output. The output of a binary phase shift key modulator is given by BPSK output is sin 2 pi FAT multiplied by sin 2 pi FCT. This is fundamental frequency, and this is the carrier frequency. By multiplying these two waveforms, we get half cos 2 pi FC minus FAT minus half cos 2 pi FC plus FAT. That is basic trigonometric function. This is 2 pi FC plus FA is the upper cutoff frequency. FC minus FA represents your lower cutoff frequency. Hence, the bandwidth is given by bandwidth B is equal to difference between both upper cutoff and lower cutoff frequency. That is FC plus FA minus of FC minus FA. It will be getting cancelled, and finally we get 2 FA. Since FA is FB by 2, that is, we are fundamental frequency is equal to the basic frequency applied divided by 2, we get the B is equal to FB. This is what the output phase versus time relationship of binary phase shift keying modulator. Input or output waveforms. The first waveform represents our binary digital input, 1, 0, 1, 0, with respect to time. This is what our BPSK output. That is, as I already mentioned, for logic 1, the carrier signal appears in phase with respect to the reference carrier oscillator at the output. Whenever we apply logic 0, we get out of phase, that is 180 degree out of phase with respect to the reference carrier oscillator. That is what the waveform is tilted. Again, for logic 1, we get in phase, that is, the phase is not at all changed. Whatever phase we are applying at the input, we get the same phase, 0 degree. And whenever there is a logic 0 input applied, there is a phase reversal. If we go to the binary question being receiver. This is what the dot diagram that depicts the receiver problem. The binary phase shifting input either plus if we apply logic 1 or minus if we apply logic 0, plus or minus sign omega 0. That will be applied to the band pass filter first. It will be given to the balanced modulator along with the coherent carrier recovery that I have already mentioned. Coherent carrier recovery is the recovery carrier signal, that is both frequency and phase angle will be the same as that of the reference carrier oscillator that is used in the transmitter side. That will be given to the balanced modulator. And because we have to retrieve the actual information which is residing at low frequency signal, we use low pass filter LPF in the receiver side. Then it will be converted, the level is converted to the help of level converter, and clock is separately recovered with the help of clock recovery circuit. Finally, we get the binary data output which we have applied in the transmitter. Mathematically, it can be treated as follows: BPSK receiver. First case for BPSK input of plus sin omega ct, that is logic 1 input. Output is equal to sin omega ct multiplied by sin omega ct. That can be simplified as sin square omega ct. Sin square theta is 1 minus cos 2 theta by 2, so half 1 minus cos 2 omega ct. That is equal to, since we use filter here, since we use low pass filter here, this high frequency term will be getting cancelled. So only we get the half voltage, that represents plus half voltage, that represents logic 1. If we go to the next case, case 2, for a BPSK input of minus sin omega ct, that is when we give logic 0 digital information signal, then the output is equal to minus sin omega ct multiplied by the carrier recovery signal sin omega ct. Then it will give minus sin square omega ct. Then that is equal to minus half multiplied by 1 minus cos 2 omega ct. If we simplify, minus into 1, that is minus half, minus into minus plus, plus half cos 2 omega ct. Again, the cos 2 omega ct is the higher frequency term which will be cancelled by the low frequency, low pass filter, and hence we get the minus half volts. This minus negative represents logic 0. Next, we have to see the quaternary phase shift keying short wave termed as QPSK. In QPSK, a very encoding scheme, number of inputs n is equal to 2. When we apply this to the number of possible outputs, m is equal to 2 power n, we get m is equal to 2 power 2, m is equal to 2. That is, in QPSK, we get 4 outputs. 4 output phases are possible for a single carrier frequency. That is what the advantage of QPSK when compared to previous BPSK. Since digital input is a binary, to produce 4 different input combinations, the modulator definitely requires more than a single input to determine the output condition. The 4 possible combinations are 00, 01, 10, and 11. These 00 is represented as dBit, that is dimensions 2 bits. 2 bits are combined, that is called dBits. The 4 possible combinations are dBits 00, 01, 10 and 11. Each dBit generates one of the 4 possible output phases, plus 45 degree, plus 135 degree, minus 45 degree phase angle and minus 135 degree phase angle, as I did in the introduction. QPSK modulator is actually a 2 BPSK modulators combined in parallel. This is what the block diagram that depicts the operation of QPSK quadrature or quaternary that represent 4 phase shift keying modulator. Initially, the binary digital information signal FB is given to the bit splitter because the FB will be splitted into 2, that is FB by 2, FB by 2, with the help of bit splitter. Bit clock is applied simultaneously to operate properly the electronic circuit.
via some clock generator oscillator. It will be given to two sections. I represents in phase channel, Q represents quadrature channel. This channel corresponds to I channel, the lower channel corresponds to quadrature channel.
Whenever same thing, whenever logic 1 input coming, then it is represented by plus 1 volt. Whenever logic 0 is applied, that is input signal, then it is represented by minus 1 volt. Similarly, here also in the Q channel, logic 1 represents plus 1 volt, logic 0 represents minus 1 volt. Since we split the actual data into two parts, we get FB by 2 as the input to the I channel, that is in phase channel, another FB by 2 to the input of the quadrature Q channel. That FB by 2 will be applied to the balanced modulator. Similarly, simultaneously, this FB by 2 in the Q channel will be applied to the balanced modulator. While applying to the balanced modulator in I channel, it will be multiplied with the carrier signal sin omega ct, which is obtained from the reference carrier oscillator that produces the necessary carrier pulses. That will be given along with the actual information signal to the balanced modulator, sin omega ct. But in Q channel, the carrier signal will be 90 degree shifted, phase shifted, and hence it becomes cos omega ct. That cos omega ct acts as the carrier signal, and that will be multiplied along with the FB by 2, actual information signal. So we get at the output either plus sin omega ct or minus sin omega ct in the I channel. Similarly, in the Q channel, we get plus cos omega ct or minus cos omega ct. That will be applied to the band pass filter. Similarly, the Q channel output will be applied to the band pass filter. Then the linear summer adds up these two outputs and produces the actual quadrature phase shift keying output. The thing to be noted here is we are first splitting the actual digital signal FB into two halves, FB by 2, FB by 2. Both halves will be simultaneously applied to the I channel and quadrature channel. In I channel, along with the FB by 2 digital information signal, we give carrier signal in phase. As I have told, plus cos omega ct and minus cos omega. The summer combines the two quadrature signal. The four possible resultant phases are given by the expressions, plus sin, that is the summer output, plus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct, plus sin omega ct minus cos omega ct, minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct, and finally minus sin omega ct minus cos omega ct. These are the four different possible outputs that corresponds to four different phase angles, plus 45 degree, plus the 135 degree, minus 45 degree, and minus 135 degree, as I have already told. So this is what the output phase versus time relationship for a quadrature phase shift keying modulator. That is DBT input that is applied to the quadrature 1 in phase 0. At the time, the corresponding signal with the phase angle of plus 135 degree. Whenever quadrature is 0, in phase is 1, at the time we get the minus 45 degree that corresponds to this waveform. Whenever we apply both in phase and quadrature as one input, then we get the plus 45 degree. Whenever both quadrature and in phase becomes digital 0, then we get the minus 130 degree. So that is what the truth table. We get the binary input. That binary input along with the QPSK output phase angle. So for 00, we get minus 135 degree. For 01 combination, we get minus 45 degree. For 10 digit, we get plus 135 degree. For 11 digit, we get plus 45 degree. If we represent the phasor diagram with the help of truth table, first we have to draw the reference axis, plus sin omega ct and minus sin omega ct. And in the y-axis, plus cos omega ct and minus cos omega ct. And we have to, the first quadrature will be filled with the 1, 1, that is both positive, that will be corresponds to the 45 degree. And similarly, the other quadrature will be taken from the truth table, that corresponding angle will be placed here.
QPSK, quadrature phase shift key, receiver part. In the receiver part, first we have to apply the quadrature phase shift keying signal as the input to the bandpass filter. For example, here I have already told for four different phase angles we get four different possible outputs. That is plus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct plus sin omega ct minus cos omega ct minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct and minus sin omega ct minus cos. In this I have taken, for example, here minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct as the input to the bandpass filter. Again I use power splitter that splits the actual input signal to the two halves. One will be fed to the in phase channel and the other will be applied to the quadrature channel. So here sin minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct, here also minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct. Here we have to use the carrier recovery circuit. The carrier recovered carrier signal must be both phase and frequency must be in phase with the actual reference carrier signal. That sin omega ct, such signal will be applied to the in phase signal and will be 90 degree phase shifted and will be applied to the product vector of quadrature channel. Here it is 90 degree phase shift and hence we will get cos omega ct. Here there is in phase, so we get sin omega ct. That will be applied to the product director. The product director output will be sin omega ct multiplied by minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct. Here also the sin omega ct minus cos omega ct will be multiplied by the recovered carrier, that is cos omega ct. So we get here minus half voltage that corresponds to logic 0. Here we get plus half voltage that corresponds to logic 1. In the final stage we will be again splitting quadrature and in phase and finally we will be getting the received binary data and the output. Mathematically, for case 1, which represents in phase channel operation, I is equal to, this is what the one of the output, possible output, minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct, that is multiplied with the recovered carrier sin omega ct. So if we multiply, we get minus sin omega ct into sin omega ct plus cos omega ct into sin omega ct. If we simplify, that is equal to minus sin square omega ct plus cos omega ct multiplied by sin omega ct. That is equal to, if we simplify by using trigonometric formula, we get minus half 1 minus cos 2 omega ct. This is sin a cos b formula, that is half sin a plus b by a plus b plus half sin a minus b. That is half sin omega c plus omega ct plus half sin omega c minus omega ct. That is equal to minus, you just take the product, minus half minus into minus plus plus half cos 2 omega ct plus half sin 2 omega ct when we add omega c and omega c plus half sin 0 because of omega c and omega c will be 0. That term will be automatically getting 0 and sin 2 term 2 omega ct will also will become 0. Because of we using low pass filter at the receiver side, it won't allow the high frequency component such as cos 2 omega ct. So it will also become 0, that is filtered out. And finally we will be getting minus half voltage that corresponds to logic 0. If we go for the second case, case 2, that is quadrature, that represents Q. Q is equal to one of the possible output, minus sin omega ct plus cos omega ct, that is to be multiplied with the 90 degree phase shifted carrier signal cos omega ct. Then minus sin omega ct into cos omega ct plus cos square omega ct, that is equal to half cos square theta is equal to half into 1 plus cos 2 omega ct minus half sin omega c plus omega ct minus half sin omega c minus omega ct. That is equal to, if we multiply in that, then half plus half cos 2 omega ct minus half sin 2 omega ct minus half sin 0. These two terms will be getting 0. And since we use low pass filter at the receiver side, the cos term, which represents higher frequency term, will be also getting 0. Finally, we will be getting plus half volt, that represents logic 1 input. The drawback in quadrature phase shifting is because of having more number of outputs, that is four possible outputs with respect to four different phase angles, the outputs are, the output phases are closer to one another. Whenever we pick one angle output, by mistakenly we may take the adjacent as a phase angle that corresponds to the next output. So this is what the problem of QPSK modulator. To avoid this, we go for quadrature amplitude modulation, shortly termed as QAM. Here in QAM, the digital information is contained in both amplitude and phase of the carrier. That is, we are not only changing the phase of the carrier, we also change the amplitude. That's what I have already mentioned. QAM is nothing but the combination of amplitude shift keying and phase shift keying. The position of signaling elements on the constellation diagram are optimized to achieve greater distance. That means, since we have both phase angle as well as amplitude, we can place it in a proper way so that we don't get any likelihood error in quadrature amplitude error. The incoming data are divided into a group of 3 bits called tri-bits, that is FB by 3. That's called tri-bits. Here, in phase and quadrature bits determine the polarity of PAM signals. C channel, control channel, determine the magnitude. As I have written, the advantages are it reduces the likelihood of one element being misinterpreted by the another element. It reduces the likelihood error and avoid noises. So this is what the block diagram that depicts QAM modulator, quadrature amplitude modulation. Here, since the input signal, input digital data, FD, is going to be split into 3 parts, that is tri-bits, we have 3 channels, Q, I, C. As we have already seen, this is what our I channel, in-phase channel, this is what our Q channel. In addition, we have C, which determines the controls, which determines the magnitude of the output. The first block is the level converter. It converts the level of the input signal to the suitable position so that it can be modulated. Then it will be applied to the balanced modulator along with the reference oscillator. Reference oscillator produces a sine omega ct to the in-phase channel. This sine omega ct is going to be multiplied with the digital information signal, and in Q channel, this reference signal will be, carrier signal will be shifted 90 degree, and we get cos omega ct, that is going to be multiplied with the FP by 3, that is input information signal, and consequently in the output of in phase modulator we get plus or minus sin omega ct, and in the output of quadrature channel we get the plus or minus cos omega ct as the output. Both the outputs are simultaneously applied to the linear summer, which adds up all the outputs, and finally will be applied to the band pass filter, which allows only a particular frequency band, that is designed for quadrature amplitude modulation. Finally, we will be getting the output. So this is what the truth table of quadrature amplitude modulation. Here both amplitude and phase angles are represented. Here also we get 8 possible outputs because of the use of, here n is equal to 3 and m is equal to 2^3, that is equal to 8 possible outputs are obtained in quadrature amplitude modulation. That is what represented here. The C channel determines the amplitude. If logic 0, then it is represented by 0.765. If logic 1, it represents 1.848. This, the first possible tri-bits is 000. The corresponding phase angle is -135 degree, and the corresponding amplitude that is determined by the C channel is 0.765 volts. The second tri-bit is 001. The corresponding phase angle is -135 degree, and the C channel determines the magnitude as 1.848 volts. That is high level. The third tri-bit is 010. the corresponding phase angle is minus 45 degree at the output, and the amplitude level is low level, and hence 0.765 volts. And the fourth derivative is 011, the corresponding phase angle is minus 45 degree, and the amplitude that is determined by the C channel is 1.84 because of the high level. That is logic one. And the fifth derivative is 100, the corresponding angle is plus 135 degree because Q is 1, and the corresponding amplitude that is determined by the C channel is 0.765 volts. The next derivative is 101, the corresponding phase angle is plus 135 degree, and the corresponding amplitude determined by the C channel is 1.848 volts. 110 tributes will produce a 45 degree phase angle at the output along with the amplitude of 0.765 volts for a low level. And finally, for 111 tributes, the possible output phase is plus 45 degree, and the corresponding high level output is 1.848 volts. The values are represented in phasor diagram. Again, this is what the sine reference sign x axis. This is the y axis. We represent cos omega ct. For example, 111 along with plus 45 degree is represented here. Actually, here 111 represent along with the maximum amplitude. The same with the lesser amplitude is 110, that is represented here. So we not only change the amplitude but also change the phase angle. Comparison of amplitude shifting, frequency shifting, and quadrature amplitude modulation. Modulation scheme, amplitude shifting. The encoding scheme uses single bit as the input. The possible outputs are 2. Minimum bandwidth is FB and the baud rate is FB. For the modulation scheme of frequency shifting, the encoding scheme uses single bit as the input, and the possible outputs are 2. The minimum bandwidth is FB and the baud rate is also FB. The binary phase shift key uses single bit. Possible outputs are 2. Minimum bandwidth is again FB. The baud rate is also FB. But the quadrature phase shift key uses digits, that is 00, 01, 10, and 11 combination, which produces 4 possible outputs. And minimum bandwidth is FB by 2 because of the power splitter. The actual information is splitted into 2 halves. And the baud rate is FB by 2. And finally, quadrature amplitude modulation, in which the actual digital data FB will be divided into 3 parts and hence called as tribits 000, 001, and so on. And the output possible are A. The minimum bandwidth is FB by 3 and the baud rate is also FB by 3. We are going to see about the pulse code modulation. In pulse code modulation, actual analog information signal will be first taken, and more samples will be taken from the analog side, analog signal. That samples are reconstructed with the help of sampling circuit to produce sample pulses. These sample pulses are used to produce modulation. The first modulation is pulse width modulation. In pulse width modulation, the width varies but the amplitude remains constant. The width, for example, the sample pulse that corresponds to minimum voltage level represents here, and the width is here, and the amplitude that corresponds to maximum voltage, that corresponds, the width corresponds to that pulse, is represents here. Similarly, for minimum voltage, the pulse width is decreased. For maximum voltage, the pulse widths become larger. So the width of the pulse is varied in accordance with the sampling pulses. Then, next one is pulse position modulation. The position of the pulse is varied in accordance with the sampling input. That is, if for positive signals, that is rising voltages, the position will be moved towards right,
But for negative signal, the position would be moving towards left, as shown in the figure. Next, pulse amplitude modulation. This is almost similar to the actual analog input information signal. That is, the amplitude level is going to be varied for the corresponding voltage level. For the low voltage level, the amplitude of the pulse amplitude modulation is lower. Whenever there is a peak voltage, the corresponding voltage becomes, the amplitude level becomes higher. That is, the amplitude level is going to be varied in accordance with the voltage of analog signal. And finally, pulse code modulation. In pulse code modulation, we will give word, 8-bit word, by using binary information 0011 to get the pulse code modulated output. Advantages and applications of PCM, pulse code modulation. With PCM, it is easy to combine digitized voice and digital data and propagate over a fiber optic cable. Pulse width modulation and pulse position modulation are used in military application, and it is rarely used in commercial application because it's very much sensitive and will give more accurate output. Pulse code modulation is the most preferred method of communication in public switched telephone network, even today in the US PST. United States, they are using PCM because of the accuracy. To determine the efficiency of pulse code modulated signal that are transmitted from a transmitter to receiver, the coding efficiency can be obtained with the help of Huffman coding technique. The steps involved in Huffman coding techniques are: the given probabilities that corresponds to different message symbols are arranged in a non-increasing manner. First step. The second step is, we have to assign 0 and 1 to the lowermost two probabilities. The third step is, we have to add the lowermost two symbols and it will be placed in the next stage. While placing the new added value to the next stage, we have to keep in mind that again the probabilities are arranged in the non-increasing manner. And this process is repeated until there is a remaining only possible two probabilities. For example, consider five message symbols M1, M2, M3, M4 and M5. These are the message symbols, discrete message symbols, having probabilities P1 is equal to 0.4. P3 is equal to, P4 is equal to 0.1 and P5 is equal to 0.1. That is, the probability that corresponds to message symbol 1, M1 is 0.4. The probability that corresponds to message symbol M2 is 0.2. The probability P3 that corresponds to message symbol M3 is 0.2. And the probability that corresponds to message symbol M4 is 0.1, and the probability P5 that corresponds to message symbol M5 is 0.1. Step 1, we have to arrange it in a non-increasing manner. The given message symbols are M1, M2, M3, M4 and M5. The corresponding probabilities are P1 is equal to 0.4, P2 is equal to 0.2, P3 is equal to 0.3, P3 is equal to 0.2, P4 is equal to 0.1, P5 is equal to 0.1. So these probabilities are arranged in non-increasing manner.
The next step is we have to assign 0 and 1 to the lowermost probabilities. The next step is we have to add these two lowermost probabilities, and the new addition will be entered into the second next stage. Now again we have to add. Before adding, we have to assign 0 and 1 to the lowermost probabilities. The addition will be taking place now. While adding the lowermost probabilities, 0.2 and 0.2, we will be getting 0.4, which is greater than this second probability 0.2. So this 0.4, the addition result will have to be placed here. And 0.2, which is smaller value, will be written in the down here. Again, we have to assign 0 and 1. Since we have three properties, since there is a possibility of having one more stage 3. Now we have to add the lowermost probabilities 0.4 and 0.2. When we add the two probabilities, we will be getting 0.6, which is greater than 0.4, which is already present in the top. So this new addition will become moved to the top, 0.6, and this become moved to the down. Again we have to assign 0 and 1. Since there are only two probabilities, it's not possible to further continue the next stage. So I can stop here. Now I have to find out the code word. From the code word, we can find out the entropy and then number of bits present in the output, and finally efficiency can be calculated. Again, the message symbols are M1, M2, M3, M4, and M5. The probabilities are 0.4, 0.2, 0.2, 0.1, and 0.1. The traced digits can be obtained in this direction. Say, for example, for the probability of 0.4, the corresponding bit is, digit is 1 when we trace in this direction, that is shown by the arrow mark. For the next probability 0.2, when we trace in the direction, it is 1 0. For the next probability 0.2, when we trace along the direction, 0 0 0. When we go for the next one, that is 0.1 probability, the traced digits are 0 1
0, 0. And finally, for the last property 0.1, the traced digits are 1, 1, 0, 0. While forming the code word, the traced digits has to be reversed. That is, the LCM has to be taken out. 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. So now, the length of code word, that is number of digits present in the code word. Here, we have only one digit, so 1. Here, we have two digits, so 2. Here, the length is 3 because of 3 bits. Here, we have 4. Length become 4. Here also, the length become 4. Now, the entropy, which tells the number of information present in the code, represented by H is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to k pk log 1 over pk base 2. Since we have 5 SI symbols, I is equal to 1 to 5. Therefore, when we expand the actual summation, then we get P1 log base 2 1 by P1 plus P2 log 1 by P2 base 2 plus P3 log 1 by P3 base 2 plus P4 log 1 by P4 base 2 plus P5 log 1 by P5 base 2. When we substitute the values, P1 is 0.4 log base 2 1 by 0.4 plus 0.2 log base 2 Since it is base 2, to convert into natural logarithm, that is base log base 10, it has to be, for example, I consider P4 log base 2 1 by P4. This can be log so this is what the method for converting log base 2 into log base 10. That is, the numerator will be log 1 by 0.4 base 10 divided by denominator will be log 2 base 10. Like that, we can simplify all this thing and we will be getting the answer as h is equal to 5.578 for this one, 4.432 plus 4.432. And when we substitute and simplify the, we will be getting the answer as, so this is 0.5. We will be getting the answer as 2.218.
And to calculate the n value, average number of bits present here, it is code word multiplied by probability. Length of code word multiplied by probability. 0.4 multiplied by 1 plus 0.2 multiplied by 2 plus 0.2 multiplied by 3 plus 0.1 multiplied by 4 plus 0.1 multiplied by 4. Finally, we will be getting answer 2.26.
The efficiency can be calculated by using the expression efficiency eta is equal to H entropy divided by average number present here, n bar, that is equal to, when we solve 2.218 divided by 2.26, we get 0.96. and if we want to calculate the percentage, then 96%. This is what the 96% is the actual efficiency obtained by Huffman coding technique that is used for pulse code modulation. This is what the final conclusion.